Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to see you all here this morning. And we also say hello to everyone watching on Zoom or those who are watching our worship later on YouTube. We appreciate you all being here and enjoying this worship service with us this morning. If you are watching online, you can use the QR code there and let us know that you're watching and sign into our online attendance form. We would really appreciate that. We have just a few announcements. We are doing midweek again, so we've enjoyed a few weeks together and would love to have more people join us. So if you are available on Wednesday evenings at 6:30 p.m., it's now dark at 6:30, so you shouldn't be out in your garden or building a fence or any, you know, all those other projects. So now that you're stuck inside at 6:30, feel free to hop on the computer and join us. We would love to have you all there with us. We've been.
There's no midweek this week.
Oh, yeah, there is.
Oh, really?
Yep, there is midweek this week. So, latest update. Okay. So, anyway, sorry, that totally threw me off. So, so we'd love to have you join with us. This week is special. I will not be on the midweek, but my lovely wife has offered to lead midweek connection this week. So, yeah, so you really don't want to miss this one because this isn't boring old Pastor John. This is exciting Pastor John's wife, Jennifer, who will be leading the midweek connection this week. So it'll be a special treat. Don't forget, turkey dinner is now just a couple of weeks away. Tomorrow's November. November 13th is our turkey dinner from 12 to 5 p.m. is when we'll be serving the meals out in our roundabout. We do have lots of volunteer spots.
Yes, lots of vacancies. Thursday afternoon, when we debone the turkey, there's going to be ice cream. I still have lots of open spaces there. And of course, on Saturday in the afternoon, as we start providing the meals.
Okay.
Lots of spots.
So if you like to debone turkeys, or if you just want to help, that's Thursday afternoons. And then we still have openings probably at all the slots, but especially Thursday and Saturday to help actually getting the meals out there and delivering them. So that is November 13th, and that would be Thursday the 11th. So see Brenda if you would like to volunteer, or you can look on the Midweek Connection and contact her via that information there and let her know. She would love to have as many volunteers as we can. So, all right. Don't forget, our charge conference is coming up. It is November 21st at 6:30 p.m. It will also be on Zoom. That will be, that's a Sunday night. So Sunday night, the 21st at 6:30 p.m., our charge conference this year will be on Zoom. It is, charge conference is when we gather together once a year to sort of review the past year and then to vote on a few things with salaries and with our leadership. So we'll be voting on those things at that meeting for 2022 and preparing for the next year to come. So if you can get on Zoom and join us, we would really appreciate to have as many people as possible at that meeting. Also, we are still updating our church directory. Somewhere is a proof copy of it that you can look through yourself. I would love for you to do that and just check off next to your name or make corrections right in the book. It probably is still sitting on the desk in the office, but we'll make sure we'll bring it out and put it out on the table there by the entrance after church so that you can do that on your way out. All right. Finally, our friendship circle is meeting this Wednesday at 10 a.m. at Joanne Bowden's home. So, hi, Joanne. There we are. So, if you are one of the women of our church, are part of Friendship Circle, you are more than welcome and encouraged to be there and to be a part of that at 10 a.m. this Wednesday. All right. So, those are our announcements this morning. And we remember that God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Amen. So I invite you now to stand as you are able or comfortable and join us in our opening gathering song. Join with me in our call to worship. God, we know you are with us.
From everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
You have showered your love upon all generations since the beginning of time.
From everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
Guide us now through this time of worship and into the week ahead.
From everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
Please join us in singing Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me. Please join me in the opening prayer. Lord, we remember the many ways in which you have helped and saved us from generation to generation. Be with us this day as we listen for your word for us in our time. Touch our hearts with your healing mercy, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
My feet on a sturdy rock. Out of his great love I've learned the meaning of salvation. Out of his great love, out of his great love, he picked me up, set my feet on a sturdy rock. Out of his great love I've learned the meaning of salvation. Out of his great love,
I had gone astray, I had lost my way, when I called upon his name. Then he rescued me, now the song I sing. What a loving God is he.
Out of his great love he picked me up, set my feet on a sturdy rock. Out of his great love I know the meaning of salvation. Out of his great love,
now I shout his praise through all my days for his endless mercy and grace. There's no other one who has greater love. Joy I will ever see.
Out of his great love he picked me up, set my feet on a sturdy rock. Out of his great love I've learned the meaning of salvation. Out of his great love, out of his great love he picked me up, set my feet on a sturdy rock. Out of his great love, I've learned the meaning of salvation. Out of his great love, out of his great love, he picked me up, set my feet on a sturdy rock. Out of his great love, I've learned the meaning of salvation. Out of his great love, out of his great love, out of his great love, salvation. Out of his great love.
Not on the screen? Okay. What? Careful. Fog them up. Okay. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and I love all faith, so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious, or boastful, or arrogant, or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end, for we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to the childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully. Even as I have been fully known, and now faith, hope, and love abide, these are three. And the greatest of these is love. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So you can imagine, I think, the number one scripture used at weddings. How many of you, that was a great question to ask. How many of you had 1 Corinthians 13 read at your wedding or a portion thereof? See, I see lots of hands sticking up. So yeah, it's very popular. I give the people that I'm doing a wedding for, I give them a big thing of scriptures. And I say, feel free to read through those and then select. Well more than half of the time, they come back with 1 Corinthians 13 as their selected scripture. And, of course, that makes sense because we all know the history. Paul was on his way to a wedding and was working on what to say at the wedding when he got there. Oh, wait a minute. No, that's not right. That's not right. That's not right. This is the 13th chapter in a long letter that Paul wrote to the churches of Corinth. This isn't necessarily about a wedding at all, is it? But I fear that sometimes we think of this as love in a marriage and not how we should love in our everyday lives. And so I want us to take some time today and think about these words from 1 Corinthians 13 and possibly how they work and apply in our daily lives. Today's sermon title is The Power of Love, and I want us to really think about that because too often we use that word, especially in our culture, maybe not those of us sitting here in this room today, but in our culture, we tend to use the word love to mean any number of things, and sometimes things that are completely opposite of what Paul is talking about here in this letter to the Corinthians, in this letter, I think, that is written to us. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant. Those are words for us to think about, and they're hard words if you really think about it, right? How many of us just figured out that marriage is super easy? Okay, good. I didn't see any hands up. No one's been married less than 6 months, because then you might say, oh yeah, it's super easy. So we know from the marriage viewpoint of this scripture that even in that marriage, these are not easy things to do. And that's kind of what I want you to think about today, is to think about how hard love really is and how much we have to work at it. To be not only in a marriage, but in a relationship with one another and in a relationship with God, right? Because what is the most important commandments? See how I come back to this and get you to say it like all the time, right? It's to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, with all your soul. And just like it, is to love your neighbor as yourself. And sometimes we don't even love ourselves, let alone our neighbors, let alone God. And so if that is our greatest commandment, is to love, then we better know what we're talking about when we're talking about love. We better take some time and think about this, right? And Paul does such a wonderful job here. That's why the scripture gets used so often. You know, if I speak in tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, what am I? A noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. I always wonder what the percussionists think when they read that scripture. What do you mean, a noisy gong? And if I have prophetic powers and understand all ministry, all mysteries, and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains. Do you remember that scripture when Jesus was talking about that? If you have just an ounce of faith, you would have enough to move the mountains. If I have all of that, but do not have love, I am nothing. Love is, according to Paul, and I think truthfully for us, is the seed and the cornerstone, the foundation upon which all of our faith, all of our trust in God has to be rooted in. It has to be the base upon which we build up our faith and our relationship with God and one another. It has to be in love. If it's not, it will crumble into dust, into nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant. What does it mean to say that? What does it mean to say that love is patient and love is kind? Is that how we approach love? Is that how we approach everyone in every situation we meet? Do we approach all those situations? I laugh even as I say that, right? Do we approach every situation with patience and kindness? Is that what we see in the world around us? Are people who are infinitely patient and kind and humble? No, it's not what we see in the world around us, is it? Just go on Facebook, or worse, go on Twitter. Nobody laughed about that. You guys are not in that generation. Or Instagram, or TikTok. And you will, you know, we all, some of us don't even want to go on Facebook anymore, right? Or any of those social media platforms, because there is such a lack of patience, of kindness, and humility. Do you see how we so desperately need those things? The problem is that it feels good in the moment sometimes to not have those things. When we get upset, when we read something, a news story, or we hear about something happening to a friend, we want to get mad. We want to get angry. We want to get even. And those are very strong emotions. Unfortunately, if we let those emotions rule us and control us, bad things tend to happen. Is that not right? Right? How many times have we let our anger get out of control, and it's caused more problems than we had to begin with, right? That's what happens, especially on Facebook or someplace like that, where there's some anonymity, where you don't really know the person that you're arguing with, or you know you're never going to see them, so you don't mind getting them upset. It happens when you're driving sometimes, because we don't know the people who are driving the cars around us. There's this anonymity to it. I'm an anonymous person, they're an anonymous person, so if I cut them off because they cut me off, then that's okay. It makes us feel good in the moment to do that. I had my own experience with road rage once. I was, back in seminary, I had to drive 3 hours to work. That was each way. From Camarillo all the way to Laverne in Pomona, which is, they're on opposite sides of Los Angeles. And coming back one night, there was a extension ladder in my lane. So if you can imagine coming up on an extension ladder, so I swerved to get out of the way of the extension ladder, and the guy behind me who I cut off never saw the extension ladder. But what I noticed was that as he drove by me, his soda cup came flying out of his window and smashed against the side of mine. Right? That's just a small little, moment of frustration and anger. He's probably had a terrible, awful day or maybe an awful week, and now somebody has cut him off that he doesn't know. Now, would that be a lot harder if we were just walking down the street face to face? Probably wouldn't get a soda thrown at me then. I might, but probably not. And if we were both going to the same church and knew each other's names, do you think I would have gotten a soda thrown at me? I hope not. I hope none of you are going to throw a soda at me as I walk out of the church today. You see, as we know people, as that anonymity breaks down, then we have patience. Then we have a little bit more kindness. But Paul doesn't say love is patient, is kind, is humble for people you know. Paul says here that love is patient, is kind, is humble, period. Right? And not just at weddings, not just in marriage, but for all of us. For all of us, love needs to be as patient, as kind, as humble. So if we are truly going to be a people of love, a people who follow the greatest commandment, to love the Lord our God and our neighbor as ourselves, then this is what it means. It means to have patience, to show kindness, to be humble. It thinks of others first. It is even-tempered. Now, Paul wrote all these in the negative, and so I thought it would be cool to take them all and try to put them in a positive light. So, he talks about how it's not irritable, it's not resentful, it does not insist on its own way, right? But I wrote it the other way around. It thinks of others first. It is even-tempered. It is forgiving. These are the things that love is, and that we need to, if we are truly going to be a people of love, these are the fruits of that. These are the ways that we act, and not just with our friends, not just with people we know, but with everyone. Love rejoices in the truth, Paul says. It bears all things. Love can see us through any time, any calamity, any challenge. It doesn't mean there's not pain and suffering. It just means that love will carry us through those times, even the times that we experience pain and suffering and loss. Love bears all things. It believes all things. It hopes all things. It endures all things. Love is eternal. Love is eternal. And in that love, we are eternal too. When we embrace love, as Paul has described it here, when we embrace that love, when we embrace that those greatest commandments truly and fully, we become eternal. Eternal and in the kingdom of God is not something that just happens when you die. It is something that is here and now. And as we embrace love, we experience that eternal, that connection, that close relationship with God here and now. And all the things that we think are so important, like when the next season of our favorite show is going to come out. How many of you get excited about the next season of a favorite show? Yeah, okay, good. I'm glad there's a few that are willing. They're like, as long as nobody else sees, I'll stick my hand up. All those things will come and go. All those things are in a moment. Paul says, but as for prophecy and knowledge, they will come to an end. Even prophecy and knowledge will come to an end. But love will not. Love is eternal. Love never ends. All the other things fall away. All the other things will come and go. But love never ends. And then he says, we see dimly in a mirror. I love that imagery of seeing dimly in a mirror. There's also another translation that says, in part in a mirror. But we can imagine looking in a mirror and seeing only part of what is really out there. Only part of what the truth is. He also made the image of, like a child, we see God and love and the world and prophecy and knowledge. We see it as a child. It's one of the reasons why I use that phrase often, that we are children of God. We are not God. We do not have all knowledge. One should always be wary of someone who comes along and says, I've got all the answers. Because we are all children. We all see dimly in a mirror. But because love is hope and love believes all things, we believe that in the time that we are reconnected with God fully and completely, we will see then in full. And Paul longs, if you read his words, he longs for that time, right? For now we see dimly in a mirror, he says, but then we will see face to face. Anonymity gone. Our anonymity that we have with God will be gone, and we will see face to face. Now we know only in part. Then we will know fully, even as we have been fully known. We should long for that day when we will stand face to face with God through Jesus Christ. We should long for that day. That should be our guiding light, so that all we do and all we say is guided by this principle and rooted in love. Rooted in patience and kindness and humility. Rooted in putting others first, in being even-tempered, in being forgiving. We should rejoice in the truth. We should hope all things And through love, we will be able to bear all things, believe all things, and endure all things. And in the end, there is faith in God. There is faith and trust in God. There is hope that we spoke of last week. And finally, there is love. There is the relationship. There is the connection that we have to one another, a connection that is established in this greatest commandment, right? This greatest commandment doesn't say, love the Lord your God, and you're good to go. Right? It's not that what they call a silo kind of faith where we just stand in a tube and we look up to God and nothing around us matters. That's not love. Our commandment requires us to not only to love the Lord our God, but to love our neighbors as ourselves. We are designed and built and created to be in relationship with one another, with everyone. Our faith and our hope guide us in the right direction. But in the end, the greatest of these is love. And when we let love be our guiding force, when we let love be what we are focused on in our relationships with one another, and our relationship with God, and our relationship with our families, and our relationship with the strangers we pass along the freeway, along the sidewalks, through the malls. When love is our foundation, our cornerstone, and what we are guided by, then we see that love never ends, and that love is the most important. And we experience for ourselves the power of love. Amen?
Amen. Please stand as you are able and sing with us. They'll know we are Christians by our love.
We have a few prayer requests this morning to share with you. Carol and Jim have shared with us several. First, for Velma, this is Carol's sister-in-law, as she has skin cancer, which has spread to her lymph nodes. So radiation started this past Friday. And so we pray for Velma and for her family, for her healing. For Velma, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
They also shared a prayer request for their friend Margie, her family, as she passed away from COVID this past week. So yet another COVID death that we are remembering and thinking about this morning. So for Margie's family, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
They also asked a prayer request for Lou and Marilyn, as Lou has entered the hospital due to having more spots on his liver. So this is yet another friend and family of Carol and Jim's. So for Lou and as he goes through treatments, and for Marilyn as he cares for her, as she cares for him, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we lift up Jim and Carol as they have experienced so much loss. These are just this week's names and families that we are remembering that they have shared. So our prayers are with you too as well as you go through all of these different times and experiences. So for Jim and Carol, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Tim and Ken have requested prayers for their friend Rosa and Mimi in Maryland. Their 19-year-old son succumbed to depression and died of suicide this past week. So prayers for the two of you as you are in mourning and trying to help them from a distance, but especially for Rosa and Mimi. We say for them and everyone who knew their son, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Kathy shared with us prayer requests for Mary, a former member who is now living in Oklahoma. Mary is having a surgery tomorrow to put tubes in her ears. So please pray that the surgery goes well and that the tubes relieve the fluid that has been causing frustrating hearing loss for her. So we pray for a successful procedure for her. So for Mary, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Holly sent us a prayer request this week for Jim, and who has had cataract surgery tomorrow and is scheduled for his last chemo treatment on Tuesday. So it's a big week for them with a lot of things going on for Jim, and so just prayers for him. This week, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
And Paula shared, if you didn't see it on the prayer list, she said, thanks for all the prayers for her sister Liz. Her surgery was successful. Everything is benign, and she is feeling much better every day. They did have to do a little bit more surgery than they expected. With a longer incision, and they did do a hysterectomy, but all is well. She will be recovering for about 6 weeks. So for Liz and for her family, for Paula, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
That's sort of a joy and a prayer, but we want prayers for healing for sure. And Bernie and Adelaide, they shared last week that Bernie was going in for surgery this week, and they were very worried about what all that was going to entail, but it turned out to be a much simpler procedure, and we're very happy that Bernie is with us. He had a small melanoma removed on his wrist, and we're joy that went very well and smoothly, but prayers for continued healing and recovery from that. So for Bernie and for Adelaide, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
And Cindy, of course, told us about Steve last week. We lift up Steve in prayer as he is receiving chemo for throat cancer. the Ziegler's. So for Steve, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We lift up prayers of gratitude for Lori, as all 8 biopsied samples were cancer-free. So we're excited about that, and we're going to continue to pray for healing from her surgery on the 19th. So for Lori, I think let's just do a joy for her, because that's awesome that all 8 of those mm-hmm. turned out to be negative. So for her, we say, in times of joy,
hear our prayers.
We lift up Joanne. She had her first cataract surgery on Thursday. And so, yeah, it all went well, so good. And great to see her here in worship today, for sure. So for Joanne, the second one will be a while, or?
Yeah, in about 3 weeks.
Okay, in about 3 weeks. Okay, so a joy for a very successful procedure, we say. For Joanne, in times of joy,
hear our prayers.
And we lift up Sarah, Deborah's daughter, who sprained her ankle. And prayers for her and for complete recovery. So
they actually think it's fractured now.
They now think it's fractured? Oh.
We'll find out tomorrow.
Okay. So prayers for all of that and the healing that will entail. So for Sarah, we say, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
And for our family, oh my gosh, we lift up Jennifer, of course. She went in at 4 out of 6 weeks and thought, oh, I'm ahead of schedule. And the doctor said, no, you're not. So 2 more weeks of wearing the boot and not walking on it any more than absolutely possible. As she put in here, I have 9 more days. Not that we're counting. How many hours and minutes is that? So for Jennifer, for continued healing, we say, Lord, in your mercy. And we ask for prayers for the whole cast and artistic team. This is Tech Week, which is why I'm not going to be at midweek this week. For Joanna and the cast of Honk, which is the story of the ugly duckling, if you don't know. And and she plays the mother duck. So she has a big part, and we want the whole cast and crew to stay well and safe. They're all wearing masks and while they do the show and all of that. So they're doing what they can, but it's cold and flu season as well. So for the whole cast and artistic team of Honk, we say, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
All right. And my parents are doing well. They all seem to be beyond the different maladies and things they had. We were praying for my dad for a while, and he had his stress test on Friday, and when they got done, I think my dad said, is that it? So at 89 and 3/4. He said it was like climbing Mount LeConte, which is a Smoky Mountain reference, Smoky Mountain National Park reference. But so it wasn't super easy, but he went through it with flying colors. So, and my mom is home and doing much better as well. So for them, we say, in times of joy,
hear our prayer.
So for Barbara and Kenneth. All right, so those are our joys and concerns, quite a few this morning. And so we lift all of these up in prayer as we join together in prayer.
Hallelujah.
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 Gracious and loving God, we thank you for being present with us this morning and each and every day. We thank you for the guidance of your Holy Spirit. for the example and presence of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for your love, which you show to us in so many ways, in which flows to overflowing. We thank you for that loving presence that is always with us. We ask that you allow and help us to share that love with those whom we meet, with our families and friends, with the strangers along the street. We ask you to especially shower your love upon those whom we've lifted up here this morning, and upon those who are in our hearts but have gone unnamed. We ask you to share your love with those in our community, those who are not on our list, who are not on anyone's list, those who feel forgotten, those who have lost all hope. And help us to be a reflection of your light and your love to all people, that your light may shine throughout the world, vanquishing the darkness, until your light shines in even the darkest corners, until all come to know your name. Help us to remember that this is our calling. Help us to remember that we are all still yet children. Infuse us with patience, with kindness, with humility. Help us to forgive others as you continuously forgive us. Help us to remember that this is what it means to be one of your disciples, to share your love in everything that we do. Help us to remember all of this as we remember the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have come now once again to our time of celebrating our gifts, and we celebrate the many ways that you continuously support our church and the ministries of this church. Now, if you're watching online, we invite you to go to the link of ramonaumc.org/give to see the many ways that you can support our church. We also invite those who are here to leave your gifts and tithes in the box which is by the front door. As we come together, we celebrate all of the ways that we share God's love, all of the ways that we share that love in real and practical ways that we do already, even as we are called in the sermon and called in our faith to be more in love, to embrace love even more. We celebrate the successes that we have now. We celebrate all that we have done to show our love to one another and to the world. We do that by standing together as you are able, and we will join together in our hymn of praise, our doxology. Please join with me in our offering prayer. From the abundant ways in which God has blessed our lives, let us share our tithes and offerings in joy and gratitude. As you have poured your healing love into our lives, O God, we now offer these gifts to you. Let them be used in ministries of peace and justice through the work of this church in your world. Amen.
Please remain standing and join us in singing Make Us One.
Go forth now with God's light shining on the path before you, with Jesus beside you as a guide and friend, and the power of the Holy Spirit filling you with love, patience, kindness, and hope. Amen.